Morning and welcome to our service today. This is our Vacation Bible School Sunday. And the theme for Vacation Bible School this week has been bird tales. So the kids learned about Jesus, they learned about birds, and how just as God takes care of the birds, so God takes care of us. Our whole service is printed in a bulletin, all the hymns and so on, so we will begin by singing our first hymn, I Am Trusting You, Lord Jesus. Service today with the responsive call to worship. Come, let us sing for joy to the Lord. Let us come before Him with thanksgiving. For the Lord is the great God. In His hand are the depths of the earth, and the mountains' peaks belong to Him. Come, let us bow down in worship and kneel before the Lord, our Maker.
Thank you.
us pray. Lord, your ears are always open to the prayers of your humble servants who come to you in Jesus' name. Teach us always to ask according to your will, that we may never fail to obtain the blessings you have promised. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. May we see you. Old Testament lesson this morning is written in the prophecy of Isaiah chapter 40. So if you had to do any work outside this week, probably got pretty wore out, right? Like a dish rag, even young people, when they're working out in heat and humidity like this, can get worn out. And Isaiah says that in this lesson, but he tells us that God never wearies, he never gets worn out, because he is always there to take care of us and protect us. If we think of birds and we think of the biggest, strongest bird, perhaps the eagle. And God promises to lift us up as an eagle. Do you not know, have you not heard? The Lord is the Almighty God. He is the creator of the ends of the earth. And he will not grow tired, and he will not become weary. No one can find a limit to his understanding. He is the one who gives strength to the weak, and he increases the strength of those who lack power. Young men grow weary and become tired. Even strong men stumble and fall. But those who wait for the Lord will receive new strength. They will lift up their wings and soar like eagles. They will run and not become weary. They will walk and not become tired. This is our Old Testament lesson. We'll sing the verses that are printed in the hymnal. The lesson for this morning is written in Peter's first letter, chapter 4. We talked about this with the kids yesterday, and that is that God did not create birds to sit in the nest their whole life, because they get bigger and pretty soon they'd be stuck in the nest and they wouldn't be able to do anything. And so birds were created to fly. God did not create us to sit on a couch all day and do nothing, but he created us to be out in the world and serve him and love to do that by loving one another and sharing Jesus with one another. And so Peter talks about this in this lesson. Serve one another, each according to the gift he has received, as good stewards of the many forms of God's grace. If anyone speaks, let him do it as one speaking the messages of God. If anyone serves, let him do it as one serving with the strength God supplies, so that God may be glorified in every way through Jesus Christ. To him belong the glory and the power forever and ever. Amen. This is our epistle lesson, and again we'll sing the hymn verses. Thank you. us rise for the gospel out of respect for the words of our Lord Jesus. The Holy Gospel this morning is written in the 16th chapter of St. Matthew's Gospel. We begin with verse 25. Jesus here tells us that the birds don't worry because God takes care of them, and so we don't need to worry either. He says, "For this reason, I tell you, do not worry about your life, what you will eat or drink, or about your body, what you will wear. Is not life more than food, and the body more than clothing? Look at the birds of the air. They do not sow or reap or gather into barns, and yet your heavenly Father feeds them. And are you not worth much more than they? Which of you can add a single moment to his lifespan by worrying? Why do you worry about clothing? Consider the lilies of the field and how they grow. They do not labor or spin, but I tell you that not even Solomon in all his glory was dressed like one of these. And if that is how God clothes the grass of the field, which is alive today and tomorrow is thrown into the furnace, will he not clothe you even more, you of little faith? So do not worry, saying, 'What will we eat?' or 'What will we drink?' or 'What will we wear?' For the unbelievers chase after all these things. And certainly your heavenly Father knows that you need all these things. But seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be given to you as well. So do not worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will care for itself. Each day has enough trouble of its own." This is our gospel lesson. You may be seated. And the kids will sing some of their vacation Bible school songs for us.
Thank you. can't give me the same thing.
Oh,
kids are going to sing. Yeah, the kids are going to sing them.
Grace and peace to you from God our Father and from our Lord and our Savior Jesus. Amen. The word of God that we look at this morning for our sermon text is from Matthew chapter 10. So do not be afraid of them, because there is nothing concealed that will not be revealed, and nothing hidden that will not be made known. What I tell you in the dark, speak in the daylight, and what you hear whispered in your ear, proclaim from the housetops. Do not fear those who kill the body, but cannot kill the soul. Rather fear the one who is able to destroy both soul and body in hell. Are not two sparrows sold for a small coin? Yet not one of them will fall to the ground without the knowledge and consent of your Father. And even the hairs of your head are all numbered. So do not be afraid. You are worth more than many sparrows. This is the word of God. Your friends in Christ. So as we've been saying all morning here, we've had Vacation Bible School this week, and the theme for our Vacation Bible School has been bird tales. And so the kids have been learning some things about birds. For example, yesterday we talked about birds wanting to fly or being created by God to fly. The day before, on Thursday, we had some bird calls, and the birds identified, see if they could pick out what those different bird sounds were. On Monday, we talked about the birds being carefree. In fact, we looked at that verse that was our gospel lesson. Birds don't worry about where their next meal is coming from, or they don't worry about where they're going to sleep tonight, because they know that God takes care of them. But do birds have fear? Are there things that birds fear? Probably there are, right? Like cats. Birds are afraid of cats. Birds are afraid of people with guns. So those are things that seem to be instinctively wired into birds to be afraid of these things. And it's put there so that they can be safe, so they can avoid these dangers. Jesus says in our text, do not be afraid. In fact, I don't know if you noticed, but that's in there three times. Do not be afraid. So does that mean that fear is a bad thing? When Jesus says, do not be afraid, is he like pounding his fist down and saying, you better not be afraid of these guys, or you're going to be in big trouble? Is that a command from Jesus? Because fear is a bad thing. Do not be afraid. Easier said than done, right? Because there are a lot of things that we can be afraid of. We can be afraid of snakes, or spiders, or the dark, or thunderstorms, or we can be afraid of heights, or we can be afraid of public speaking, or we can be afraid of standing up and giving a sermon in church and forgetting where you are and then getting stuck in your sermon. We can be afraid of that. We can be afraid of getting sick. We can be afraid of passing away. All these things are things that we are afraid of. And so when Jesus says, do not be afraid, is he like pounding his fist down and saying, you better not fear? Or is it a little different? Is it, in fact, Jesus like tenderly inviting us and saying, come to us and don't be afraid? Kind of like a mom would say to her three-year-old when she comes running into the bedroom in the evening during a thunderstorm. Come, don't be afraid. I'll take care of you. I'll be with you. It seems like that's more what Jesus is saying, right? He's inviting us to come to him, saying, don't be afraid. And in fact, he gives us reasons in our text why we do not need to be afraid. And so this will be our theme for our sermon today, do not be afraid. First of all, Jesus says, because there are things more important than this life itself. And then secondly, because there is nothing in all the world more important to God than to us. So do not be afraid. What is fear? And what are things that we are afraid of? Well, if we want to know anything nowadays, what do? We talk to Google, right? And Google tells us. So that's what I did. I said, Google, what is fear? Define fear for me. And Google said, fear is an uneasy emotion. So it's not necessarily rational, it's emotional. It's an uneasy emotion that comes from believing that someone or something may harm us or threaten us or bring us danger. And then Google also said we seem to be wired for fear, and it actually talked about that part of the brain where fear comes from, and we get wired that way for fear. And so in that respect, fear can be a good thing, because fear kind of looks at things and says, don't do that. things that would be threatening or things that would be dangerous for us. So just like cats or birds are afraid of cats, so we learn to be afraid to jump off a cliff, right? That would be a foolish thing for us to do. And so in that respect, fear is good. Google also talked about overcoming your fear. How do we do that? Well, Google says you can like breathe through it and just breathe and try and relax. Or Google said you could kind of think rationally about what it is that you're afraid of and look at the evidence and see, is this really something that I should be afraid of? Or it says you should face your fear, and that way you can maybe overcome your fears. For example, fear of spiders or fear of clowns. Nobody likes spiders, right? They're very ugly. Nobody wants a spider crawling up your arm. But if we think about it, a spider is just a little bug, and we are way bigger than a spider, and all we have to do is step on it. You don't have to be afraid of that. Same thing with clowns, right? If you think about clowns, the clowns that are frightening and scary seem to always be the clowns in the horror movies. So if you're not in a horror movie, you probably don't need to be afraid of clowns, because the clowns that we normally meet are trying to make us laugh and trying to make us happy. So we can face our fear and try and overcome our fear, Google says. But there are fears that are real for us, because there's things that are threatening for us or things that do hurt us. For example, sitting in the doctor's office and waiting to hear the results of our tests. And that can be very scary, because it could be something very bad that we have to hear. Or maybe it would be the loss of income. Maybe we get laid off from our job or some other loss of income, and then we're afraid of how are we going to make ends meet? How are we going to pay the bills? Or maybe it's a fear of this person not being in my life. Maybe we just seem to clash all the time. We just can't seem to get along. And maybe we're going to split up and this person is going to walk away and says, I don't want to be in your life anymore. And we're afraid of that. And even if it seems like everything in our life is going just fine, now everything is hunky-dory, in the back of our mind, there's still that fear that everything could just change in an instant, right? And it might not be the way it is right now. And so fears are real, and because danger and heartache is real. And so Jesus doesn't want us to live in fear. And so he comes to us in God's word today, and he encourages us to help us gain perspective and to tell us that there are things that are more important in this life than this life itself. Going back to our text, he says, so do not be afraid of them, because there is nothing concealed that will not be revealed, and nothing hidden that will not be made known. What I tell you in the dark, speak in the daylight, and what you hear whispered in your ear, proclaim from the housetops. Do not fear those who kill the body, but cannot kill the soul. Rather, fear the one who is able to destroy both soul and body in hell. So what is Jesus talking about here? Some background, some context, some perspective. In this whole chapter 10, Jesus is sending his 12 disciples out to travel through the towns and villages of Galilee and to preach for him. He's sending them on a preaching tour. And in the whole chapter, he's telling them what to do and what to think and what to say. And so he says, what you hear, proclaim it on the housetops. Don't be afraid. However, he also says there's a very real possibility that you may be persecuted when you're doing that. In fact, the verse right ahead of our text says that this is very likely this is going to happen, because he says if the people hate the master of the house, then they're going to hate the people in the house. He says if the people call the master of the house Beelzebub, then they will call you Beelzebub. But he says don't be afraid, because, well, he says don't be afraid of those who can kill the body or hurt the body but not the soul. So in a way, he's saying, well, it could be worse, right? Someone might hurt your body or kill your body, but it could be worse. So you should be afraid of standing before God on Judgment Day. And maybe that's kind of a morbid thought. Well, don't fear, because it could be worse. And the disciples may have asked, well, what could be worse than getting beat up for Jesus or being killed for Jesus? And all we have to do is ask Peter, what would be worse? If you remember, Peter's sitting in the courtyard of the high priest, warming himself by a fire, and everyone around him was like the enemies of Jesus. And he was very afraid of what they were going to do to him if they found out. And so three times he denied knowing Jesus. And then when the rooster crowed and he realized what he had done and Jesus looked at him, then he knew what would be worse than getting beat up for Jesus, and that is to deny Jesus. He felt just awful and went out and wept bitterly. And later on in his life, when the same opportunities came again, he boldly stood up and confessed his faith in Jesus and was tortured and persecuted and even put to death for his faith in Jesus, but it would be worse to deny him, Peter believed. Or Jesus says it would be worse to stand in front of God on the last day without your faith, be afraid of the one who can destroy both soul and body in hell. And that's what he means when he talks about revealing what has been, you know, whispered will be revealed to all. So he's talking about the last day when everything becomes clear, everything is revealed to all, and there we are standing before God. And what if we, out of fear of being persecuted or fear of losing our life, would lose our faith? He says that to the disciples. What would that be for you? That would be worse. If nothing could be worse than that, right? So if something horrible would happen to us, very painful, and we would curse God the way Job did not, but we would curse God and we would tell our friends and our family, I hate God because he has ruined my life and I want nothing to do with him. That would be a bad situation, and then it would be made worse by what we would say, or if we would lose our faith. But if something horrible would happen to us and we would say to our friends and family, this hurts a lot, I can hardly bear this, but I put my trust in God because I know that he will see me through this, that he has a plan for me and he will take care of me and he will see me through this. And so that would be better, right? Giving glory to God that he is with us. Now that being said, it's not just black and white, and when troubles and hardships do come, it can be hard for us to have that kind of strong faith. But we know that the Lord will still be with us and will help us through this because he promised and because he loves us. What the troubles of this life also show us, Jesus reminds us of, is that, as we said, there's more important things than this life, and that is heaven. This is not our whole life. This is not where we're going to end up. This is not where we're going to be forever. We're going to heaven. And there it's going to be awesome. Just think, if our life here was perfect, we wouldn't even want to go to heaven, right? Because we would be in heaven on earth. Everything would just be hunky-dory here and everything would be perfect. And so when the troubles of this life come to us, they show us that this is not where we are meant to be forever. If our life was perfect here, then maybe we would just be caught up in all the worldly things, what we eat, what we drink, what we wear, the things that Jesus talked about, and we wouldn't even be thinking about Jesus or heaven or all of that kind of stuff. But when we go through hard times, Jesus uses that to bring us back to him and keep us close to him. And so Jesus says, do not be afraid, because there's more important things in this life. And when the fears and the troubles of life come bearing down on us like a freight train, and we go, how are we going to get through this, or what are we going to do? Then Jesus also says to us that we can find comfort in knowing that he cares about us and will always be with us. Because he says in our text, are not two sparrows sold for a small coin? Yet not one of them will fall to the ground without the knowledge and consent of your Father. Now when you read about this verse in the commentaries, it tells us that back in Bible days, sparrows were used for food. Like poor people who couldn't afford better meat. And so sparrows were sold in the marketplace, and people would buy them and clean them up, and they would roast them, and they would eat them. But they were very cheap. We're used to the word penny from different translations. The small coin that Jesus talks about was worth more than our penny. But still, the point is, you can go to the market and you can buy two sparrows for one small coin. In fact, the commentators say that if you wanted more for two small coins, they'd throw in an extra one. You could get five sparrows for two small coins. So not very much. That's the point. However, Jesus says, if the God of the universe, who created all things and who takes care of the stars and where they're all going and then takes care of everything in the universe, if he knows and cares, whenever a sparrow falls, or whenever a sparrow hits our window, he cares about us, because we're worth more than many sparrows. He says, even the very hairs of your head are all numbered. Wow, that's crazy to think about, isn't it? Do you know how many hair you have in your head? For some of us, it might be easier than others, but how much hair do we have in our head? It's hard to know, isn't it? It's impossible for us to know. When you comb through your hair, brushed your hair this morning, how many hairs came out in your brush or laying on the sink? Did you count them? Oh my goodness, there's seven hairs. I lost seven hairs, and I'm down to so many. We have no way of knowing. It's impossible. But God knows how many hairs we have in our head, because we are that precious to him, because he cares about us more than anything. And so Jesus brings it all home in that last verse when he says, you are worth more than many sparrows. Let's say you have an older car and starting to have some problems. The head gasket is leaking. Transmission is starting to slip. You look underneath and there's a fair amount of rust under there. And so how much is that car worth to you? How much more money are you going to put into it? You're going to get these things fixed, because those are expensive fixes. Or are you just going to put it on the junk heap, send it to the junkyard, because it's not worth that much anymore? When God looks at us, how much are we worth to him? When he sees all of our rust and all of our leaking head gaskets and seeing we're starting to slip, and I'm not just talking about the rusty joints and the aches and the pains, but I'm talking about what's in here and what's in here slipping into sin, and the rust that happens from our sinful attitudes. And when God looks at us and sees all of that in us, how much are we worth to him? Are we worth fixing? Or does he just want to throw us on the junk heap of humanity? How much are we worth to him? What is the value of the blood of the Son of God? What is that worth? That has to be worth a lot, doesn't it? But we are worth more to God than the blood of the Son of God, because God sent his only Son to die on the cross for us so that we could be fixed, so that all our sins could be taken away, so that we can belong to him. The creator of the universe, everything he made, we are number one. He loves us and values us more than any of these things. And therefore, the Apostle Paul wrote to the Romans, I just took my marker out of that, put my marker in Matthew, so let me just find it here. He says, indeed, he who did not spare his own son, but gave him up for us all, how will he not also graciously give us all things along with him? If God loved us enough to give Jesus for us on the cross, won't he take care of everything else in our life? And sometimes it might be something that we think is good for us, but God says, no, I don't think that's what I want you to have. That's not going to be good for you. And sometimes it's something that we like, this is not going to be good, but God says, I'm going to take this and make it work out for good to you. Why? Because I love you and I care for you more than anything. And so Jesus says three times today, do not be afraid. Because there's more important things in life than this life. And one of them being God, our Heavenly Father, loves us and cares for us more than anything. And so that's our confidence as we go through life. Amen. Now let's rise. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, shall keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. Amen. Now let's join in confessing our faith. We'll use the creed that's printed in the bulletin. I believe in God, our Lord and Father in heaven, who made us the crown of his creation and preserves us with every good thing that we may live before him in peace and joy. And I believe in the Lord Jesus Christ, God's only Son from eternity, who became a man for us sinners, who redeemed us from Satan's power with his holy precious blood, rose from death, and made us his own to live with him now and forever. And I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who draws us to our Savior by the gospel, who keeps us united in the true faith, forgives our sins, and at the end of the world will raise us from death to life eternal. Amen. And you're laughing, okay. Morning, we include a prayer on behalf of Bob Miller and Pam Schenecker, who are in the hospital but are now home, but we pray for their continued healing. Also, Rose Mace is going to Kenya, Africa this week, and so we'll pray for her. Oh God, our Father, we thank you for adopting us as your children and making us your heirs of everlasting life through Jesus Christ. As your dear son, as your dear children, we have the privilege of bringing our sins to you for pardon, knowing that they have already been paid for by Jesus. We are confident that whatever things we ask of you in Jesus' name, you will give us, and that as a kind and concerned Father, you will continue to bless us for your love's sake. We ask, therefore, that you listen to our troubles and bind up our many pains and hurts. And through the Holy Spirit, give us a childlike faith which does not doubt or hold back, but simply trusts you for everything. As your children, may we learn to do good to everyone, especially fellow members of the household of faith. Teach us to recognize the needs of others and be generous in sharing our goods with them. May we pray for their behalf and be quick in offering them our counsel and aid. May our lives as your spiritual children be avenues to others for the tender mercies with which you rule all your works. And Heavenly Father, we thank you for every day of health that you have given to Bob and to Pam, and for every measure of strength that you have granted them. And now we come to you in their hour of suffering and ask that you would restore their health and their strength. Especially on behalf of Pam, we pray that you would end the pain of her sores in her leg and grant them both your healing and your blessing. We dare to ask this of you, sinners though we are, because we know that Jesus, our brother, died for our faith, for our sins. And dear Lord, we pray for our Christian sister Rose, who will be going to Kenya this week. We pray that you would bring her safely to Kenya and keep her safe in all of her travels throughout the country. While she is there, empower her with your love and your compassion and your skill, that she may be a good nurse to those in her care. Give her the courage and wisdom to speak your name to others as she has opportunity. And grant that all those people that she touches may be blessed with healing for their bodies and the sweet comfort of gospel for their souls. We also pray for her safety as you bring her back to us. All of this we ask in your name, and in your name we join in praying. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look on you with his favor and give you his peace. Welcome and good morning. Glad to have you here. I see some visitors today, so if you're visiting us, we're especially glad that you could join us for our service today. I direct your attention over here. First of all, there's a bucket. There's a bucket for our church offerings, but there's also a bucket for progeria research in honor of Megan Nibers, so that's on the chair, I believe. But then also, there's a bake sale, so all kinds of goodies there. So go on over and have a look and help yourself. The lady said if you didn't know there was going to be a bake sale and you didn't bring your cash, that's okay. Just go ahead and take something and we know where you live. We'll find you and we'll shake you down. No, they didn't say that, but they said you can bring your offering, your donation anytime. So yeah, there's a lot there. So please go over and have a look. Also, if you're interested in some produce, so share your produce back. There's produce on the table in the office. And so you're welcome to go there. There's bags. You can just help yourself there. We could use some help from able-bodied people. And that is, it's a top announcement on the back page there. We're having the floors waxed this week and the carpet shampooed. So there's a trailer in the back there. Everything in the basement, tables, chairs, everything except for the piano and the bookshelves needs to go in that trailer or stuck in the bathrooms. And everything up in the front of church, the flower stands and communion stands, all that stuff needs to be off the carpet so it can either be stuck in the sacristy and the other one or laid on pews or whatever, but that's all got to be out of there. And then next week we could use some help cleaning all that. So thank you if you're willing to and able to help with us that, with that. We want to thank everyone who helped with Vacation Bible School. So our teachers were Kayla Eigel and Tricia Krentz and Kim Schuneman and Mara Vandenbrink, and you saw them up here today leading the kids. Our thanks to Pam for doing music. We also had helpers this week. Lainey Hannafeld, Morgan Krieger was here. Denise Off helped out. Lily Off was here every day. So we thank them for that. Belinda Fox helped pick out the crafts. Somebody who didn't get his name in the bulletin was Professor Guggenheimer, so he was here every day to teach the kids about birds. He came from the University of Stuttgart in Germany and came all the way over here to teach our kids about birds, so we're thankful for him. Orders meeting was two weeks ago, and it says in there what took place at that meeting. Mariah Schultz-Dirks was granted a release, a new copier. And then, as we said, the floor is clean. Some Thursday evening services, if you're interested in that or come to that, there'll be some Thursdays when we won't have that service, as we'll be gone. And then, so Bob Miller got out of the hospital on Tuesday and is in the nursing home, the resident home, and getting therapy there. And so we pray that that continues. Pam Scheniger got out of the hospital, I think it was Thursday. But still, her infected leg is still quite bad, so we'll keep them in our prayers. And Rose going away on Thursday, so the Lord be with you, and we'll keep you in our prayers that He blesses your work there and brings you safely back with us. Any birthdays or anniversaries? Yes, David. Your mom's, her right there. Okay, your mom's birthday was yesterday. Happy birthday, Brenda. Okay. Grandpa and Grandpa's anniversary. Yes. So there and there, happy anniversary to you guys. Yes. Here and here, we're not sitting together either. Ours is tomorrow. So how many years for you guys? 46, okay. 41. We're way younger than you guys. Oh, it just took a long time. Forgot to drop him in my lap. That's what happens. Roger, birthday? Yeah? What day? Saturday? Yesterday? Oh, coming up? All right, happy birthday. Anybody behind any trees? Anybody? All right. Well, again, glad you were here. Thanks also to the kids for singing today. You can talk amongst yourselves and dismiss yourselves and have a very good week.